We continue now at the top of Daf Kuf Mem Dalet Amud Beis Meseches Shabbos. This is Shabbos Daf 144b. The Gemara is bringing a brisa to prove that everybody agrees, even the Rabbanan agree, that if you have other fruits which are not normally squeezed for their juice, so if juice comes out of those fruits on Shabbos, you are allowed to use that juice on Shabbos. So the brisa says, Bepagoyin, Rashi says, prunes, that refers to prunes. Uvaparishin, Rashi says, that's kvidins, which is quince. Uvauzradin, or crab apples. And all of those things, if you squeeze out, it's not a problem of dush. Avaloborimonim, but the one thing you're not allowed to squeeze, the brisa says, is pomegranates. Rashi says, d'orchayubachi, it's normal to squeeze out pomegranate juice. V'shal beis menashe bar menachem ha'yusochtim berimonim. As evidence, the brisa says that in the house of Menashe bar Menachem, they used to, Rashi explains, on the weekdays, they would squeeze out pomegranates for their juice. So you see that it's a normal thing to squeeze. Therefore, on Shabbos, it's aser. So this brisa shows that other than pomegranates, by other fruits, we permit you to squeeze out the juice on Shabbos. So you see that everyone's lenient. Gemara says, and we might the Rabbanan, but how do you know this brisa is the Rabbanan? Dilma Rabbi Yehuda, maybe it's Rabbi Yehuda. The whole point of this is to try to prove that even the Rabbanan are makel by other fruits, but we don't know who the author of this brisa is. But the Gemara says, v'tehavi nami Rabbi Yehuda. But even if this was Rabbi Yehuda, emor d'shamat leila Rabbi Yehuda yatsu me'atzman. The only thing we've been discussing until now is not when you're actively squeezing the fruit for its juice, but if the juice comes out on its own, can you use it? Sochtin l'chatzchila mi'shamat le. We never heard Rabbi Yehuda say, go so far as to say that you can actually be sochet these fruits l'chatzchila on Shabbos. But this brisa seems to say you can even do that. Elamai is loch lememra. What is there to say? Kevin delab b'nei schita ninu afil lechatchila. Apparently, from here we see that fruits which are not b'nei schita, fruits which are normally not squeezed for their juice, even lechatchila on Shabbos, you're allowed to squeeze it. So therefore, afil tamer rabbanan, you might as well say this price is even the rabbanan. Kevin delab b'nei schita ninu, since they're not things that are normally squeezed, afil lechatchila, it's going to be mutter even lechatchila. Shma mino rabbanan hi, shma mino. You see, this is the rabbanan. And the Gemara says this is a good proof. Rashi here says, Elamayis loch lememra, what are you going to say? L'Rabbi Yehuda came in the lab b'nei schita, v'chi hechit l'Rabbi Yehuda shori l'chatchila mehai taima. Once we say Rabbi Yehuda allows it l'chatchila, mehashta afilu teima rabbonin v'sharu le mehai taima. Even the rabbonin would allow it for this reason. And the Brice also said, shal beif menashe bar menachem hayu sochtim berimonim. The evidence that pomegranates are problematic was that in the house of Menashe bar Menachem, they used to squeeze pomegranates even during the weekdays. You see that it's a fruit that is normally used for its juice. Amar Rav Nachman says, halacha, kishal beis Menashe bar Menachem. This is the halacha. The halacha is that we're strict because of the practice of the house of Menashe bar Menachem. So Amar Le Rav Rav Nachman. Rav said to Rav Nachman, Menashe ben Menachem Tanahu? Is Menashe ben Menachem a Tanah? What are you saying that the halacha is like him? Rashi says, Menashe Tanu Bitmiya. V'chi'iyu polig lememar devashabbos aser detayim hilchas hakavasa. He wasn't the one saying that it's aser on Shabbos. V'halu huzgur ela liv divrei hatana l'raya dehay tana hu savar kavasa. The point of bringing Menashe bar Menachem was just to show an evidence that these things are normally squeezed. Try to show that it's aser on Shabbos. You wouldn't say the halacha is like Menashe ben Menachem. It doesn't make sense. And v'chi teim, if you're going to say what Rav Nachman meant was, halacha ki haitana desavar lo kashal Menashe ben Menachem, that the halacha is like the Tana who holds, like Menashe ben Menachem, but that's also problematic. U'misham desavar ki Menashe ben Menachem halacha kamoso. Menashe ben Menachem have a ruba d'alma. The fact that Menashe ben Menachem goes like this Tana, that's not the majority of the world. Just because he had a practice to do something means we should paskan like that. V'chi teim, ha'da amar halacha kashal beis Menashe ha'chi kamar halacha ki haitana de'osar ben rimonim. Hoil v'koim Menashe kevasei. The halach is like the Tana that forbids it on Shabbos because Menashe follows that, because the practice of Menashe goes along with that. To sochten rimonim b'chol, because he used to squeeze rimonim in the weekday. Alma b'nei schita ninu have a ruba di alma d'mishom iu l'chudei nashvi derech rimonim l'schita. Because of this one guy, we're going to decide that rimonim are normally squeezed for their juice. Doesn't make any sense, but the Gemara says no. In, it does make sense. To Tanan, we have a similar situation in the following Mishnah. Hamekayim kotzim bekerem. Let's say somebody is growing thorns in the vineyard. Rabbi Lazar omer kiddush. Rabbi Lazar says that's a problem of kilayim. The chachamim omer meinu mekadesh. The chacham say it's not a problem of kilayim. Eladover shekamo mekayim. Unless it's something that normally people are mekayim, something that people want to use for food, for themselves or their animals, but otherwise it's not considered kilayim. The Amar of Chanina, and Rabbi Chanina says my time with Rabbi Eliezer. So what's the reason of Rabbi Eliezer? It's true. Kotzim are not something that people normally purposely keep in their vineyards. Shekein baravia mekayim and kotzei sados ligmaleim. No, the kotzim actually in this particular place, Aravia, they would actually keep kotzim for the camels. The camels would eat them, so it was grown on purpose, and therefore Rabbi Eliezer says you have to be strict. So the Gemara says, the Gemara is bringing a proof. The Gemara says, oh, you see that just from one location, we're able to make a psak halacha that this is a normal thing to do, and therefore we are strict. So the same thing over here by Menashe ben Menachem. He normally squeezed the pomegranate, so we're strict on Shabbos. But the Gemara says, not a proof. Me, the Iria. What is the comparison over here? The Aravia Asra. Aravia is not just one person. It's a whole place. It's a whole location. So that's, Rashi says, that's Chashivas Darab. You have a public place, a large area. That could be something that we go by. Hacha, Bad Ladaito, it's a Kaladim. But this is one guy who happens to drink pomegranate juice. That doesn't mean anything to the rest of the world. So what's the comparison? So the Gemara says, Ela Hainu Taima Kedrev Chista. Rather, the reason really is like Rav Chista. The Amar Rav Chista, because Rav Chista says as follows, Tardin shesachtan v'nosnan b'mikvah. He says that if you have beets, which you squeeze, the beet juice, and you put it into the mikvah, poslin es ha-mikvah b'shinoi mare. If it changes the color of the mikvah, it makes the mikvah pasul. So the Gemara asks, v'hala b'nei schita ninu. But tardin also are not b'nei schita. It's not something you normally make juice out of. So the issue is, it should not be considered, we'll see in Rashi a little further, but it shouldn't be considered a mashkit, a pasul of the mikvah. Elamai is lechlamemra, what do you have to say? Kevan dach shevinu havelu mashke, since this person considers it important, it's considered a mashke. Hachanami, kevan dach shevinu havelu mashke. That's the reason over here also, when it comes to pomegranates, the idea is if you make it chashev, if you decide you want the juice, then it's considered an issue, and it can be an issue in Shabbos. So it's not that the ruba the alam, it's that it actually goes by the person who's doing it. Rashi says over here, Elahainu taima de Rav Nachman damar halacha ein sochtin. The real reason why Rav Nachman says the halacha is we can't squeeze the pomegranates, k'Rav Chista, because he holds like Rav Chista. Even though to the rest of the world this is not a mashke, if this person considers it important, it becomes a mashke. Now, according to this, we're going to have to re-explain the brisa, because according to this, anything you squeeze on Shabbos, you're considering important. So why would he make a difference between pomegranates and the other things in the brisa? So he says you have to explain as follows. Sochtin b'pagoyin ufarishin l'masik hapri. What's going on in the brisa is you're not squeezing for the juice. You're squeezing to sweeten the fruit itself. V'lo l'tzarach ha-mashke. You're not interested in the mashke. That's the only way to explain the brisa. Because if you're interested in the mashke, they'd all be usher. Avolo b'rimonim v'afilu l'maskan. And then the brisa says, but when it comes to pomegranates, even to sweeten, it's a problem. The shel beis menashe ha-yusochtin b'chol l'tzarach mashke. Because beis menashe used to do it for the purpose of mashke on weekdays. Hilkach b'shabbos usher afilu l'masik. Therefore, on Shabbos, it's a problem. Because even if you want to sweeten it, it's a problem. Because there's one person out there who does it for mashke, we're afraid. Not that Menashe is the majority of the world. It's just that we're afraid. If we let you do it to sweeten the fruit, you're going to do it for mashke. And since this guy is considered as an important, it's a problem. But by pagoyin and the other fruits in there, we're not concerned. It's just never going to happen. In other words, the fact that there are some people, even if they're not the majority of the world, that squeeze pomegranates for juice, so we're afraid you might end up doing that, and if you do it, you're considering a chash if it's going to be a problem, so we forbid it altogether. But when it comes to fruits that nobody squeezes for the juice, then already we're not going to say, if you're going to do it just to sweeten the fruit, we're not going to say, oh, we're afraid that you're going to do it for the mashke, because nobody does it for the mashke, so there's nothing really to talk about. So in any case, that's Rav Chista's answer, and that's why Rav Chista says, and Rav Chista uses this, Rav Chista is getting this from what we say by mikvah. One other point we'll make over here, b'shinoi mara, just explaining in the mikvah case, it said that the tardin, they pass on the mikvah by changing the color. Lo b'shloshes lugin, delo huzkaru shalosh lugin el b'mayim she'uvin. We're not talking here where you have three lug. That's not what we're talking about. There's a halacha that three lug can pass on a mikvah. That's by drawn water. Avol shar mashkin lo pasli elim kein nishtana mara ha-mikvah yedein. But other liquids, they passel only when you change the color. That's what's being referred to over here when it talks about Shinoi Mara. But in any case, that is the answer of Rav Chista to how Rav Chista explains why the halacha is like Rav Nachman. Rav Papa says, Mishum da havedomer shein osin mimenu mikvah lechatzchila. The reason over here actually is because it's something that you can't make a mikvah out of lechatzchila. Mechol domer shein osin mimenu mikvah lechatzchila posel etz ha-mikvah v'shinoi Mara. And according to Rav Papa, any item which cannot make a mikvah passels the mikvah if it changes the color. Rashi explains what Rapapa is going on. Rapapa amar taima de tardin la mishum chashivusa. Rapapa is really arguing on the mikvah case. We brought the mikvah case derech agav. We said, the mikvah case has to do with chashivus in order to explain our brisa about squeezing on Shabbos, about squeezing fruit on Shabbos. Rav Papa has a different explanation of the mikveh case. He says it has nothing to do with the fact that Tardin, you're making them chashev, you're not making them chashev d'achshevinuhu, uliolam lav mashkenenu. He says, really, it's not a mashke. Tardin is not a mashke. V'had the mifsil, mishum d'chol davar she'en osim yimenu mikveh, she'en o mayim, o sheleg, o borod, any item which you are not allowed to make a mikveh out of, if it's not water, snow, hail, those are things you could make a mikveh, but anything you cannot make a mikveh, posel es ha-mikveh v'shinemar, apostles v'shinemar. In other words, the point of Rav Papa is, it has nothing to do with mashke or not. It doesn't have to be a mashke to pasel the mikveh. Anything that cannot make a mikveh can pasel the mikveh v'shinemar. Tanan Hasam, we learned over there in the Mishnah. Nafal l'socho yayin o chometz, if wine or vinegar, u mochel. Mochel is like the water that flows from the olive. Vishina marav, if that falls into the mikveh and it changes the way it looks, pasel, it is pasel. So another Mishnah that has to do with paseling the mikveh. So the Gemara says, Man Tana de Mochel Mashko. Who is this Tana that says that Mochel is considered Mashke? Rashi over here says, Man Tana de Mochel Mashko, Kasalka Daitach Dein Mikveh Nifsel Ella Al Yedei Mashke. Right now we think, like we said initially, that a mikveh is only possible through an actual mashke, through an actual something that's considered a drink. Ve'afilo b'shinoi mara, even with shinoi mara, it needs to actually be a mashke. That's what we think right now. Going back here to mochel, Rashi says, O mochel v'ukamin mayim v'zav min azesim. This is actually like water that flows from the olives, as we said before. V'gimul minim yeshbo. Rashi explains, this is going to be relevant later on in the Gemara, there are three types of mochel. Kishatorin mitchila b'maton lehischamim ulisbashel me'elein mochel zav mehen. Initially, when you begin to press the olives, you get this thing that's called mochel v'utzolol kamayim. That's clear like water. Ul'achar she'omdu yomim, after a few days, it sits there. B'doch guzezeh, the olives press against one another. Chozer mochel lozov mehen. Then mochel comes again, this liquid. V'ukar of lios k'shem, and that already looks more like oil. Ul'achar she'otzer, and after it's gathered together, lehotzi shamnan b'beis habad, to take out the oil, that's the final. So there's three stages of mochel that come out of these olives. So in any case, returning to our question, the Gemara asked, who is this Tana that says mochel is a mashke? Amar Abaya says Rabbi Yaakov. It's the Tana Rabbi Yaakov. The Tanya, as we learned in a brisa, Rabbi Yaakov, Amar Rabbi Yaakov says mochel hareyu kamashke. Mochel is considered a drink. Umatam amru mochel hayotze b'tchilatar. Now, if it's considered a drink, as we said, mashke is something that can become, if it's really a mashke, it's tameh. So why do we say that the initial mochel that comes out of the olives, as we said, there are three stages. Why do we say the initial mochel that comes out of the olives is tar? Lefisha'eno rotze b'kiyuma, because that mochel, the guy doesn't want. Rabbi Shimon Omer mochel eino kamashke. Rabbi Shimon disagrees. He says in general mochel is not mashke. Umatam amru mochel hayotze meikol beis habad tameh. Why did we say that the mochel that goes from the basket of the beis habad, that it's tameh, lefishi yefshar lo below tzichtzuche shemen? Because that part of the mochel has within it, it's got to have some actual real oil, therefore it is tameh. So they're arguing, so in other words, everyone agrees that the mochel that's yosei me'ikol beis habad, that's for sure tameh, that's the mochel that has oil within it, and everybody agrees the mochel that comes out initially right away at the beginning, that for sure is not considered kamashke, because he doesn't want it. So the Gemara just asks to clarify, mai beinayu, what is the difference between these two opinions? Because if they're both agreeing by these two cases, what's the third case? And the Gemara says, ika beinayu da'asi basar itzta. Rashi will explain that. But in any case, the point here is, the main point we're bringing is that Rabbi Yaakov says mochel hareyu kamashke, so Rabbi Yaakov is the Tana that says mochel is like mashke. Rashi here says, what's this basar itzasa? The asar basar itzasa la'achar she'ischilu l'ischam. As Rashi explained, there's a point in time where the olives are pressing against one another and they're warming each other up. V'doch guzezeh, they press against one each other. V'nishtu ha'komer yam, it stays for a few days that way. And as Rashi said, the oil comes out. That in that particular case, or the mochel comes out, and that is the case that they're arguing about. Again, Rabbi Yaakov says that kind of mochel is considered kamashke, and Rabbi Shimon says that kind of mochel is not considered like a mashke. Now, Rava Amar Rava says, Mishum dehave davar shein osin himenu mikvah. So he says, no, the reason why the mochel passes the mikvah has nothing to do with mashke. Again, similar to what we said before, but rather it's because mochel is something you cannot make a mikvah out of. Uposel, it's not mikvah v'shinoi marin, as we said before. Rava here holds, like we said before, that anything that you can't make a mikvah out of lechatchila, it passes the mikvah if it changes the color of the waters of the mikvah. Amar Rav Yudah Mar Shmuel, Rav Yudah says the name of Shmuel. Sochet Adam Eshkol Shela Novim L'Soch HaKadeira. So a person on Shabbos is allowed to squeeze a cluster of grapes into a pot, Avalo L'Soch HaKa'ara, but he can't do it into a plate. Rashi here explains. L'Soch HaKadeira Shel Tavshil, let's say he's cooking something in a pot, L'Sakno, he wants to put in some of this this grape juice. Demucha milsa de lav lamashke boila. If you're putting it into a pot where you're cooking food, clearly you don't want it for a mashke. Ela laochel, you want it for food. Ve'ein zederech prikaso v'havik kemafred ochel me'ochel. That's not considered like dosh. You're not extracting liquid from the grapes. It's like, because really, it's not grape juice. You're not making juice. You are putting the juice into your pot. You're making food. So it's like cutting food from food. If you're allowed to cut a piece of food in half, it's no different. Avalola socha ka'ara, but you can't squeeze it onto a plate. Dezimnin de lamashke koi. Because sometimes you will be using it in such a situation for mashke, or in some situations you will be using it for mashke. The afagav de ka'ara lo shasi inish. Even though people usually don't drink out of a plate, lo mukha milsa, it's not clear. Ve'ika iser, and there's an iser. So in other words, you might actually want it as food when you're doing it into a plate, but it's not 100% clear what you want it for. When you're doing it into a kadeh or into a pot and you're cooking food, it's 100% clear it's for food purposes. There's nothing to worry about. When you do it into a plate, that's when he says it could be problematic. That's what Rav Yudah says in the name of Shmuel. Amar Rav Chissa says, Midivrei Rabbeinu Lamat Nilmat, from the words of our rabbi that just said, again, this idea of making a distinction between a kadeh and a kar, we learn out as follows. Cholev Adam Eiz Lesocha Kadeira. Similar. A person can milk a goat into a pot. The milk goes into a pot. Avalo Lesocha Kar. Again, you're not allowed to do it into the plate for the same reason. Alma Kasavar Mashke Habala Ochel Ochel. Now, the Gemara derives from all of this. We see that apparently these Amoroim hold that a mashke, which is going directly into food, has a status of food. That's why it's not considered schita, because it's considered extracting food from food, which is not a problem. So on that principle, Mesiv Rami Bar Chama. Rami Bar Chama asks as follows. Brisa says, Zav shecholev esoez, let's say a zav whose tame is milking a goat, hacholav tame. The milk is considered tame. So the Gemara says, V'i amrit mashke habola ochlin ochelhu. Now, if you're going to say that mashke, that liquid that goes to an ochel is an ochel, B'may iskasher, how is this becoming? How does this get hechsher to be mekabel tum in the first place? Rashi says over here, hachol of tame shazav mitame called over b'masa. The halacha is a zav is mitame anything he lifts up. Vare hesedaki luach, he's causing the stream, he's moving the stream. V'lo kamaflik bein l'socha kader bein l'socha kos. Rashi first says the idea of the kasha here is it doesn't matter whether you're doing it into a kadeira, into a kos. They don't make any distinctions. So even when he's doing it into a kadeira, apparently it becomes tummy. V'yamer ochelu. Now if it's food, ha'ein ochel mekabel tumah shelo behechsher. If it's food, it cannot become tummy without getting what we call a hechsher lekabel tumah. Means it has to touch some liquid. V'hai b'mayas kasher. But here this entire stream is considered to be food. So how is it ever mekabel tumah? Clearly, it's not considered food. It's considered a liquid. So the Gemara answers no. Kedamar Rav Yochanan betipa hamulcheleches al piadad. There's a little drop of milk on the opening of the udder. Hachanami betipa hamulcheleches al piadad. Rav Yochanan said that in a different scenario. Here also, we can give that same answer. Rashi here says Kedamar Rav Yochanan meseches krisas gave ha'isha shenatav chalav midada. It's talking about a woman over there who has milk coming out from her. Betipa hamulcheleches al piadad. Tipa rishona melacheleches ba piadad bedas v'nochale chalav. What apparently happens is the first drop that comes out is a mashke, and you actually want it there because it makes it easier to do the rest of the milking. That's like normal cholov. That's considered a mashke. So in fact, what's going on is if this zav is milking the goat, what actually happens is the first drop that comes out is a mashke, and it's machshir all the rest of the drops. Even if those other drops are considered ochel, they are now ready to be mekabel tuma, and that's why they're tame. Mace of Ravina. Ravina asks, Tomei mace, shasachat zeisen v'anovim, if a Tomei mace is squeezing olives or grapes, and we'll continue with this question in the next video, on Daf Kuf Mem Hei Omid Aleph.